8 ways that you can get started in real estate right now with little or no money down. Hi, Paul Price here with Retire Rich with Real Estate. And today I want to talk to you a little bit about how to purchase a property with little or no money down. And you know, there's a lot of books been written on this subject. There's a lot of people who have systems they'll sell you on how to do this, but it's really not that difficult. If you, you know, have marginal or good credit and you have a little bit of cash, you can get in fairly easy to real estate. And that's really what I did when I first started in 2002. I had good credit. I didn't have a whole lot of cash, and I had just gotten married. We had just purchased our first house, my wife and I, and it was a FHA loan. We only had to have like 3% down, and you know, it was a pretty easy process. So I thought, well, buying a rental property should be very similar, and it is, but it's different. And one of the things I found out when I started trying to buy a property was that most banks required, instead of 3 or even 10%, most of them wanted 20% down to do a loan for an investment property. Well, and the reason for that is investment properties are, you know, more likely to go into default. That's their argument, I guess. You know, there's more risk involved because you don't live in the property. You're probably more likely to let it go if it starts losing money for you and you can't make the payments. And the banks don't want to be in the real estate business, so they know that that's just more risk for them. So more down payment ensures that you have more skin in the game and you're less likely to let the property go back to them. And that's all they're concerned with. But due to the fact that I had good credit and I went around to several different banks, I did find a bank that would let me buy a piece of property with only 10% down. Now, that's still quite a bit. But in this case, I bought a property. My first property was a duplex. I paid $56,000 for it, which is not a huge amount of money, but I had to come up with, you know, $5,600 basically, plus the closing cost to close it. And I had the money to do that, and that's what I did. But if I didn't have that money, how would I have gotten started? One of the easiest ways to get started with no money would be to do wholesale assignments. Now, wholesaling is usually when you have a person who's buying a usually a distressed property and they're turning around and selling it to someone like me, who is a person who's going to fix it up and rent it or flip it and you make a profit on it. So you're going to make a little small spread in there, and maybe as little as $5,000 to $10,000, you know, profit basically for just finding the property. You don't do anything to the property, you don't fix it up, you don't usually do anything except turn around and sell it. Now, an assignment is very similar to that, except you don't actually close on the property. You assign the contract. So you go out and you find the deal, you make the agreement with the seller of the property, and then you go out and find a buyer on the wholesale side, and you say, hey, I've got this property under contract, and I'll sell you the rights to the contract, basically, and they will actually close it and fund the deal. And that's what we've done several times. We've done both wholesaling from people who actually own the property and have closed on it, and then we buy it from them. And then we've also done the assignment route, where we buy the rights to the contract and they actually never own the property. They never get the keys to it. The property goes from the seller to us, and they get basically what amounts to a commission, you know, because they're in the deal, but they're, you know, they don't really actually take possession of the property. Sometimes they do a double close, which is where you close the first deal and then turn around and close the second deal like 30 minutes later. Just depends on how the title company wants to handle it. But regardless, it's a pretty simple process, and it requires little or no money in most cases out of the person's pocket that's finding the properties and doing the wholesale assignment. It's a good way to get started. Now, it's a hard thing to do. It's not always easy finding these properties. There's a lot of legwork and a lot of, you know, beating bushes to find the deals. And that's why people like us are willing to pay for them, because it saves us all that time and energy if you find the deals for us. Number two, the second way you could start with little or no money is to try to manage other people's properties. Find people who are rental owners who don't want to manage the property. A lot of times people have inherited a property or they have a property that they, you know, they didn't really set out to be rental owners, and maybe they were single and they got married and they moved into, you know, the spouse's home, and they have this extra home and they didn't sell it, or they decide we'd like to keep it as a rental, but they're not really professional landlords and they're willing to let someone else manage the property for them. That's what you're looking for. If you can find somebody like that that's willing to let you take over that management duty, gives you experience. You learn how to manage a property, and also you can make money doing it. It's not usually a whole lot of money. Typically, when you manage someone's property, you charge usually the first month's rent for finding, like a finder's fee for finding the tenant. And then typically it's somewhere around 10% a month ongoing the whole time they're managing it. Now you will handle the phone calls. If the tenant calls and says, hey, my toilet's leaking or my faucet's dripping or whatever, you're gonna handle all the phone calls. You're gonna set up the repairs and things like that. But that cost isn't coming out of your pocket. That's coming out of the owner's pocket. You're just handling all those things for them. And you're gonna be probably responsible for collecting the rent. And if they're not paying the rent, you know, calling or, you know, going over and knocking on the doors and, hey, where's my rent? Things like that. That's going to be your responsibility. But those are things you need to learn how to do anyway if you're going to own your own properties down the road. So getting started is a good way to get your foot in the door and get your feet wet trying to learn the management side of the business. Now, you should know, in some states like Tennessee, to represent someone else in any kind of real estate transaction, including being a rental manager, you need to be a real estate agent if you're signing the leases and things like that. If you're just managing the repairs and things like that, I think you're okay. But if you're getting into signing documents on their behalf and things like that, you need to be a real estate agent. So just understand that. You know, if you're just doing one or two properties, this probably isn't a big deal, but you do need to know that that could be an issue. So just research that. But it is another way for you to get in with little or no money and learn the business and then use that knowledge as you go forward. The third way you could do this is through owner financing. If you can find an owner who's willing to lend you the money basically to buy his own property, and usually they're going to do this at a higher rate or at maybe a higher premium price, they'll sell the same house that they might sell for cash for $60,000, $70,000. They might sell it to you for $80,000, you know, or they might take a 6 or 7% interest rate, whereas if you went to the bank, you could probably get 4. So, you know, they're going to get a premium out of it. But there again, if you don't have good credit and you don't have any money, this may be a way you can get in. Usually there's two typical ways of doing owner financing. There's usually either just a traditional financing scenario where you go and do a closing and you take title of the property, and then the owner, who is basically the bank in this situation, puts a lien on the property, and if you don't pay the bills, then he has to come and foreclose on you to get the property back. The second way you can do it is through what's called a contract for deed. That's a situation where you make payments to the owner, and at the end of the time period, if you're doing a 5-year or 10-year or whatever the loan is, at the end of the loan period, then he will sign the deed over to you. But during that time, you got to remember, he is having to keep insurance on the property and taxes paid on the property, and you're doing all the maintenance on the property. So you need to make sure if you do that, that all those things are getting done, because if he's not paying the taxes and he's not paying the insurance and something happens to the property, then you're out all your money. So it's good if you're going to do that kind of situation to maybe get a third party, like an attorney or a title company or somebody who might handle the funds, where you just pay them as a third party and they make sure that the you know, the insurance and the taxes and everything are escrowed and paid out, and they hold the money until the contract for deed is fulfilled. So just something to think about. But that's number three, owner financing. Number four would be rent to own. Now, rent to own is similar to owner financing. you know, in a rent-to-own situation, you're signing an actual lease. Usually how this works is, if let's say I have a property that rents for $600 a month, and you're going to purchase it, you're going to do rent-to-own, and we're going to say, I say I'm going to sell it to you for $60,000. And you need about 10% down to get your loan at least at the end of the 5 years. So it's 60 months if you have 5 years, and I'm going to add $100 a month to your payment. So now instead of paying $600 a month, you're going to pay me $700 a month. But I'm going to take that extra $100 a month and I'm going to put it aside. And I'm going to save that for you. And so that ends up being $1,200 a year. And in 5 years, 12 times 5 is 60. That's $6,000 saved up. And so now you've got a $60,000 house. You've got $6,000 saved up. So you've got your 10% down. So now you're paying a little bit of premium on the rent. This is a house that would rent for $600 normally. You're paying $700. I'm taking, as the owner, I'm going to keep $100 a month in kind of an escrow account on the side, so that at the end of 5 years, I'll have $6,000 saved up of your money, and I'm going to give that to you so you can go get a loan and finance the property. And then at that point, that $6,000 will be applied to the loan, because that's your money. Now, you've lost all that rent in there because you're renting the property. You're not building any equity per se. You're building the $6,000, but you're not building anything other than that. But it allows you to get into a property if you had no money down. At the end of 5 years, you've got $6,000, and you've also agreed upon a price for the property now that you can pay for down the road. If the house is worth 60 now, 5 years from now, it might be worth 70 or 75. So you may be able to get a good deal. It's possible. But that's typically how a rent to own scenario works. Number five, you could do a lease option. Now, a lease option is a little different than a rent to own. You sign a lease with an option to purchase the property at the end of the lease. So say you do a 3-year lease. If I say you can buy this property at $60,000 3 years from now, but I'm going to charge you $500 for the option to buy that property, and you agree to it. So over 3 years, you'll rent the property from me and you'll sign a lease. At the end of that time, you can decide, hey, I want to buy the property or I don't want to buy the property. Either way, I keep the $500. The $500 is your right to purchase it at that price 3 years from now. So that's what you're buying. You're buying the right to purchase a property at a specific point in time for a specific price. So that's how that works. Now, in these last couple of scenarios I've talked about, rent to own and lease options, typically you're going to be the person who is living in the home to do those. If if you're going to try to do this as a rental property, and this is something that you can do, you may have to make sure that you can have the ability and the right to sublease. Because some landlords like me, I don't, in my leases, it specifically says you cannot sublease my property. And that's to protect me, because I don't get to choose the tenants and things. And so a lot of landlords don't want to do that because they want to control the property, and rightfully so, because that's a risk to them if they don't have the ability to control the property. So make sure, if you're going to do this as a rental scenario, then you need to make sure you have the ability to sublease those properties while you're trying to buy them. Another thing you can do is a sublease, where you just go in and lease the property, and you get a right from the owner, and you tell them up front, always be honest about this and say, hey, I'm going to lease your property, but I'm going to turn around and sublease it and rent it again. If you've got somebody who's willing to do that and they're okay with that, that may work out well for you. You lease the property and you turn around and sublease it to somebody else. And in a scenario where that might work well is if you're near a college or something and you want to, you know, maybe you lease a big house with like 3 or 4 bedrooms, and then you sublease those bedrooms out to college students, you know, like one bedroom at a time. Sometimes you can make more money doing that. You know, be creative in how you come up with ideas on how you want to, you know, rent properties. I've known several other investors that do just that. They buy properties and they rent it out by the room, and they make a lot more money than they would just renting the whole house. But you have to get permission from the owner if you don't own the property to do that. Another thing you could try is a partnership. And of course, in a partnership, each person has to bring something to the table. If you have no money to get started with, what are you going to bring to the table? Well, you can bring your skill sets, your labor, your time, your effort. If you're going out finding the deals and bringing them to someone who maybe has money but doesn't have the time to go find the deals, then you guys have, you know, a mutual interest there. You both want to buy rental properties and investment properties, but someone doesn't have the time and you have the time. So that makes the partnership good, because you each have something that the other person doesn't have. So you're bringing something unique to the table. And if you're lucky, you may be able to find an experienced investor to work with who may be able to mentor you a little bit, help you find properties and tell you, you know, look at the deal. You think you might bring a deal and you say, this is a great deal. And they may look at it and say, no, it's not that good of a deal, and here's why. And so you learn how to find deals, and it could help you a lot, because everybody has different skills and talents. And if you bring two people together, it's two heads are going to be better than one at finding deals and learning how to be creative in investing. So a partnership is a good way to get started, especially if you don't have any money. Now, you may not end up with a 50-50 partnership. You may end up being a 25-75 or whatever, but at least you're getting in the game and you're learning as you go along. And so down the road, you know, you can be a better investor. So it's a good way to get started. If you don't have any funds, try to find someone you can partner up with who does have the funding. Number seven is house hacking. Now, I've always thought this would be a good idea. I'm kind of sorry I never did it myself. I didn't buy my first rental property until after I was married and had a kid, so it wouldn't have worked out so well then. But when I was single, this would have been a great deal, and it still can work as a family. You just have to buy a bigger unit. But I bought a small duplex. That was my first property. Paid $56,000 for it. Put a little bit of money down, and I put like 10% down. And my rental units on either side, my payment was like $400-something a month. And then they were renting for about $450 a month on either side. So I was making about $900 a month on the whole thing. But if I'd lived in one side of it and rented the other side, that one side would have been enough to probably pay the mortgage, or pretty close to it. And I would have just had to pay for the incidentals, like the repairs and maintenance of the property. So that's one way you can get in with little money down, just a little bit of a down payment. If you've got some credit and you can get the loan, you can get in and you have a property that where you live basically mortgage free. You're not paying, you know, they're paying the mortgage for you. So you really don't have a lot of expenses. You got to pay your utilities and, like I said, your maintenance costs, and that's it. The taxes and insurance were even escrowed into my payment. So it was really, it worked out really well for me to do that. If I was, you know, single as a small unit, it would have been hard to do with a family. But you can do that with a duplex or triplex or small property, get in there and do what we call house hacking. And that's what it is. Basically, you're living in one unit while you're renting the other units, and the other units are basically paying the mortgage, and it allows you to get in with little to no money down. So just keep that in mind. It's a good option if you know, if it works for your lifestyle and you can find the right property. Last but not least, there's hard money lenders. Hard money lenders, now what do? They typically invest with people like us. They go to investors and they lend money to them to buy properties that wouldn't otherwise finance conventionally. These properties are usually properties that need extensive remodeling, and they're in bad shape, and the banks won't loan on them because they just don't have enough value. You know, if you have a house that's worth, you know, that someone's selling for $70,000 and it needs $30,000 worth of work, the banks may not want to lend $100,000 on it to you because it's not worth $100,000. And that's what you need to buy it and get it fixed up so you can rent it or sell it. So that's where the hard money lenders step in, and they'll say, hey, we'll lend the money to you, but it's going to be at a high rate. It's going to be 8, 10, 12% interest, and it's going to be a short term, usually going to be 90 days or 60 days or 120 days. It's going to be a short term loan, and they're going to want their money back pretty quickly. So if you're going to come in and buy it, fix it up real fast and put it on the market and sell it, then you can, when you sell it, you can cash out and give their money back to them. That's what a lot of these flippers were doing for, you know, back in the late 2000s. And a lot of them got burned because they were using hard money lenders. And when the market crashed, they couldn't sell these properties that they'd been fixing up. And then they didn't have the money because they had to sell the property to pay back the hard money lenders. And they ended up defaulting on a lot of them. And I had some friends that were in that mess too. So I never got into that, but it is a possibility there. Again, if you need money, it could work for you. Make sure the deal's right for you. Typically hard money lenders are only gonna be really beneficial to someone who's gonna flip the property, because you're gonna have to pay that loan back in such a short period of time. You're not gonna make the money back if you were renting the property in that short period of time. So keep that in mind. You're gonna be using that more in a flipping scenario, but it is an option to keep in your toolbox. So there you have it. 8 ways you can get started right now in real estate investing with little or no money down. If you enjoyed this video, please press the like button, subscribe to my channel, and hit the bell for notifications. That way you know when we release new videos. Thanks again. You have a great day, and good luck out there.